So good morning everyone, welcome to this early morning news session on instruments and investigations in ophthalmology. I am your ophthalmology educator Dr. Vineet Sehgal and welcome to this session. This session is basically meant for those students who are the PG aspirants, and also this session would be useful for the students who are in their third year, because these instruments and investigations can be asked in your exam, in your third prof exams in practical and viva also. So before I start the session, this is the compulsory voice and the video check. Am I audible to all of you? Just give me a thumbs up. Okay, fair enough. So I am your ophthalmology educator, Dr. Vineet Sehgal. You can just download the Unacademy Learning app from the iOS store or the Play store, and you can use my code, that is the Ophthal10, to basically enroll for any of the batch that you want. And we have a lot of combat quizzes that are coming up. And today we would start the session on initially with the instruments in ophthalmology, and after that we would do the investigations in ophthalmology as the time permits. So give me a thumbs up everyone if you are basically having a lot of josh in basically attending this session. Okay, fair enough. So first of all, we have to see what are the different type of instruments that can be used in ophthalmology, and they are almost looking similar. So first one is this one. If you can appreciate, in this instrument, what are the important points that you have to see? So you can grip this instrument from here, okay, and you have two prongs here, okay. So basically any of this type of instrument which can basically use to hold something, what it is called? It is called a forceps, okay. So this is a forceps. Now a similar instrument can be like this, okay. In this instrument you are seeing that there are cutting edges, okay. So whenever you cut something, then what I call it? I call it a scissor. So see again, this is a forceps and this is a scissor, okay. Similar instrument can be like this, and if you can see here the ends, they are blunted and rounded, and basically what they can do is they can hold a suture, okay. So holding something can be basically done by this instrument, okay. So can you tell me what are the name of these instruments? So this is the first one, okay. I call it forceps. I call it Macpherson's forceps. Okay. This one is a scissor, okay, a smaller scissor. I call it Westcott scissor. Then this is something, a holder, what I call it? I call it needle holder, okay, to basically hold the needle of a suture. And I have made this all of them in front of you so that you can appreciate the difference in all of them. A forceps, a holder, and a scissor. So I write it F, holder H, and this one is a scissor. Is it clear all of you? Just give me a thumbs up. Okay. So now let's see few of questions for you. So what is this one? Your options are Westcott scissor, Macpherson's forceps, needle holder, or wire rectus. I just told you. So appreciate, this is something which is used for cutting, okay. And whenever we use something for cutting, very good Dr. Amrit, we call it a scissor, Westcott scissor. So what is use of Westcott scissor? It can be used to cut sutures during intraocular surgery. If we have a posterior capsule rupture and we have vitreous tag which is coming in the anterior chamber, it can be used to cut that also. So any fine thing, if you have to cut, you can do it with the Westcott scissor. Okay, so let's move to our next question. Dr. Sonika, a lot of welcome to my this session. Okay, so this is if you have a scissor which is bigger than the Westcott scissor, okay. So remember, as the tissue gets bigger, and stronger, we have to use a bigger scissor. So then, if you have a, in your Viva, if any one of you is a third year student, and in your Viva, you have variety of scissors that have been posted. So the smallest one is the Westcott, then it is the corneoscleral, and the largest one is your conjunctival scissor. So for cornea and the sclera, you use corneoscleral scissors. The smaller one you use for cutting the sutures, and the largest one you use for cutting the conjunctiva. Okay, now what is this instrument? Westcott scissor, Macpherson's forceps, needle holder, or wire wet test? Try to answer. So welcome Dr. Avinash, Dr. Sonika in the session today. So we are just starting the session with the various instruments that are used in ophthalmology. So very good. This is a Macpherson's forceps. And now tell me, what is the function of Macpherson's forceps? Where I use Macpherson's forceps, they can ask you in your practical exam, also in your final exam. So see here. Do you have two prongs here, and this can be used to hold anything. Okay, so holding a suture, tying a suture, okay, this can be basically, or even holding a intraocular lens, a PMMA intraocular lens, a hard rigid intraocular lens, you can use this forceps, which is called Macpherson's forceps. Okay, now see the Macpherson's forceps. See its ends here. Okay, do not confuse a forceps with a scissor. Okay, so now this is an instrument which I use in my intraocular surgeries. Identify this instrument: MVR, keratom, crescent, or Macpherson's forceps. What are the important features that you have to see here? Something which has a handle and a biplanar structure. Okay, so what it can do is, it can go inside, make a tunnel, and then dip inside. Okay, so what is this structure called? What is this instrument called? And see the edges, more sharper edges. Okay, and what, where are your sharp edges? Here are your sharp edges, and these are your blunt edges. So these are sharp, I write S, and this is blunt, I write B. So this is basically a, very good Dr. Sirsat, this is a keratom. Okay, so if you can appreciate, this is something, a keratom of two different sizes. Okay, it may be this one, maybe around 2.8 millimeter, and this one is a smaller one. Okay, I can say maybe around 2 millimeter. Okay, what keratom does is that this is your cornea. So remember, kera word in ophthalmology comes with the cornea. So it can cut the cornea. After cutting the cornea, it can dip inside and make a plane. So my incision that I would make here would be something like this. Are you understanding? Give me a thumbs up. Okay, so it would have a tunnel. You would ask me, sir, why not make a blunt incision? Why not make a blunt incision? Why you want a biplanar or a triplanar incision? The answer is, I make a biplanar and triplanar incision in the cases of intraocular surgery because these are self-sealing. Are you getting my point? So they can basically seal like this, okay? And you do not need to put any suture. So these are made like this so that they can make a dip. And what they can do is, they can basically have an entry in the cornea. So keratoms are a very important instrument whenever we do an intraocular surgery, like a phacoemulsification surgery, like a trabeculectomy surgery, like a surgery in your like your corneal transplant. So you can use keratom anywhere there. But if they ask, the most common use of keratom, it is your phacoemulsification. Okay, so the most common use of keratom is doing a phacoemulsification surgery. Okay, now a similar instrument is like this, as Chahak has asked me. What is this instrument? Your options are MVR, keratom, crescent, or Macpherson's forceps. So see, both of them are almost similar, but it has more rounded edges as compared to this one. So what is this instrument? Check, you got your answer. So very good, Amrit. The answer here is C, that is crescent. Okay, so see the edges here. It also has sharp edges, but it has rounded curvature. See here, this is more of a triangular surface and this is more of a rounded contour. Okay, so this is this instrument that is used is your crescent. Okay, both can be used for making the incisions in the tissue, but whenever you are using crescent, can you see you have rounded edges? So it can basically make a rounded opening, or it can basically dissect some tissue. Okay, so if you have a tissue like this, what it can do go is it can go inside and it can dissect the tissue. Okay, where I need to dissect the tissue or separate the tissue from its plane, can you tell me what are the uses of crescent? It can dissect the tissue and make a plane. So remember, this crescent, where I can use it? I can use it in my surgeries like pterygium, where I have to dissect the conjunctival mass from the cornea. Also, I can use it to make a scleral tunnel in your small incision cataract surgery, okay, where I make a scleral tunnel. Then last but not the least, we can also use it to make a scleral flap in a trabeculectomy surgery. Can anyone tell me where we use trabeculectomy surgery? What is the indication of doing a trabeculectomy surgery? So it can be used in your advanced uncontrolled glaucoma. Okay, so these are the various uses of a crescent blade. Are you getting my point, everyone? Okay, so see again how to distinguish between the keratome and a crescent. I have put both the figures in front of you. This one is a keratome and this one, this is your keratome and this one is your crescent. Okay, do not confuse between both of them. Okay, then there was an option which was written a MVR blade. Okay, so can you see a very sharp blade here, which is having sharper edges here and the blunt edges here. Okay, something which you can see like this. Okay, so what it is doing is it is making a stab incision inside the sclera or any of the tissue. Okay, so this is called MVR blade, or I also call it micro vitreoretinal blade. Where you use it? You can use it in making incision or stab incision anywhere in the eye. You can make it around the limbus when you have to put the side port in your phacoemulsification surgery. Also, MVR blade, you can use it in making the ports, three ports in your pars plana vitrectomy. Can anyone tell me where I use pars plana vitrectomy as a surgical option? So what it can do is it can make a opening around 4 millimeter from the limbus in a pars plana vitrectomy surgery. Tell me in the comment section where we use a pars plana vitrectomy surgery. So a pars plana vitrectomy surgery, I use it whenever we have to operate a patient of retinal detachment or any vitreous hemorrhage. Okay, very good, Dr. Jack. Now let's move to the next instrument. What is this instrument called? Iris repositor, Calesion clamp, enucleation spoon, or wire rectus? Try to answer. So how you can see, you are seeing a ring like structure in the end of this instrument. Okay, so this is one model and this is second model. In the second model, I can put a syringe also. Okay, When I put a syringe, I can basically push the saline from this, and also I can aspirate the material from this. Okay, what is this instrument called? Tell me in the comment section. So this instrument is basically called a wire vac test. Okay, wire vac test. So what is the use of a wire vac test? We use it in the cases where I do a small incision cataract surgery, or whenever I do a extracapsular cataract extraction. So this is my eyeball and this is my nucleus. Okay, I have removed the anterior capsule and now my nucleus is there. To remove this nucleus from the corneal incision to the outside, what I can do is I can put this wire vectus beneath the nucleus. Okay, so what it would do is it would basically help you to give traction in this direction. Can you appreciate? It would give a traction in this direction and this would basically then move out from the corneal incision, the nucleus. Okay, so this is not IOL removal, it is the removal of nucleus in a patient of small incision cataract surgery, or in an extracapsular cataract extraction, we can do it. Okay, this is a wire vac test. Okay, another instrument which is like this. What is the name of this instrument? It is also used in your small incision cataract surgery and your extracapsular cataract extraction. What is the name of this instrument? So the name of this instrument is called C, that is Simcoe's cannula. Can you see a fenestrated end here? And you have a opening where I can put a syringe here. So what I can do here is I can basically aspirate the material. Okay, so after the cataract surgery is done, I have removed the nucleus. So still some cortical material is left behind. Okay, few cells here and there in the bag. So what I can do here is I can use this instrument to go inside. Okay, and then it can aspirate this material. Okay, so this is basically a Simcoe's cannula. Do not confuse a Simcoe's cannula with a wire vac test. Okay, so this is your Simcoe's cannula. This is your Simcoe's cannula. And this is your wire vac test. Give me a thumbs up if you are able to understand whatever I have taught till now. Okay, fair enough. Okay, so what is this instrument called? Is it an iris repositor, chopper, Sinsky hook, or wire vac test? Another instrument which is used in a cataract surgery. But remember, this instrument is basically used to cut the nucleus in a phacoemulsification surgery. So see the edges here. Something which can cut. Okay, this is your nucleus. I am putting this instrument and doing a nucleotomy or cracking of the nucleus. What is this called? It is not used to hold something. It has very sharp edges. It can cut a nucleus. A very big hint that I am going. Anyone want to try to change your answers? So most of you have put it as C. But it is not something which is a hook. Now can anyone change the answer? Okay, very good. It is a chopper. Okay, so see the edges here. Can you see the edges here, Avinash? Can you see the edges here? So something which can cut. Okay, this is, and see the direction. See the direction. Okay, it can basically use to cut something. This is a chopper. What the chopper does is that it can go inside the nucleus and then it can basically cut the nucleus into various fragments. I call it chopping of the nucleus. Like you chop your onions na, the similar way you can chop the nucleus by this chopper. A very similar instrument is a Sinsky hook. So I have put both of them simultaneously. If you can see the edges of a Sinsky hook, it also looks like same. But specifically what I have given is, I have given a edges of this. So can you see more blunt edges here? As compared to this one, I have specifically put the image here. You are seeing more sharp edges here. Give me everyone a thumbs up if you can appreciate. I show you again, sharp edges in a chopper and blunt edges in a hook. Okay, when you want to basically hold something, you do not want to damage that. Okay, so that's why a Sinsky hook, where it can be used? It can be used to basically hold something. Okay, or what it can do is, this is your intraocular lens. Okay, then we have to put the intraocular lens, and then I have to hold the optic and I have to turn the intraocular lens. So turning the intraocular lens or basically holding any tissue, you can do with the Sinsky hook. Okay, this is very good. This is called dialing the IOL. Okay, or basically extraction of tissue with Sinsky hook, because it is such a blunt edges, it would slip away. So I do not use it for extracting something, but definitely I would use to hold something. Okay, I would use to hold something. For prolapsing the nucleus during the delivery, I would use not Sinsky hook. I would use basically in that case wire vectors. Okay, Vinash. Okay, a similar instrument can be iris repositor. So in iris repositor, in addition to this one, you have a straight edges and something with the angle. Okay, but see the ends. Ends have no nothing to hook or chop. Okay, so this is iris repositor. If during a cataract surgery you have, what you have got is, you have basically got iris extracting from the corneal incision. With this blunt edges, you can push back the iris. Okay, this is called iris repositor. Is it clear, Dr. Sonika? Avinash? Okay, so do not confuse between these three instruments. See it once again and give me a thumbs up. Please like the session. So this is a chopper, Sinsky hook, and a iris repositor. Okay, so now I have put all of them in one slide so that you can compare. So what is this one? This one I write it one, I write it two, and I write it three. Mark your answer in the comment section. What is one? What is two? And what is three? So these are my actual instruments. They are not taken from Google. So this, they have the maximum chances to get repeated in your exams. So one is having sharp edges and it can cut something. What is one? So my one is chopper. Two is something which can hold the tissue. So what is my two? Two is my hook. What is my three? Three is my something which can move the iris inside. This is repositor. So if you are liking this session, I would request to subscribe for the Let's Crack Neat PG YouTube channel. And if you want any other videos in the coming month, just let me know. Okay. So now this is an instrument which I can use. Can you see this? The rounded cutting edges. So it can cut a tissue. So what is this? Wire vectus, Calesion clamp, Calesion scoop, or corneal trephine? Try to answer. Something which is on a base, through which what I can do is, this is my tissue. It can go inside the tissue and cut a portion of the tissue. Okay, So what I would left with, I would left with a corneal tissue. So this is called a corneal trephine. Okay, very good. This is called a corneal trephine. So where I use a corneal trephine, where I have to basically do a corneal transplant. You can see here that in a corneal transplant, the central area is the clear tissue, which is of the donor cornea. So remember, whole of the cornea is not replaced. The central area of the cornea, which is at the visual axis, that 7 to 8 millimeter is replaced. And this one is your host tissue. Okay, so this one is your donor tissue and this one is your host tissue. And what are the sutures which are basically holding the donor and the host tissue? These are the 10-0 monofilament nylon sutures. Also, let me know that corneal transplant is done when we take donor eyes and put it in the host eye. So donor eyes are basically preserved in which media? This can also be your question. My question is, donor med tissue is preserved in which medium? Can you name any of the medium where I basically put the donor cornea? So media can also be asked in your exams. If you have to use it within 48 hours, you use a moist chamber. Within 48 hours to 72 hours, if you want, you can use MK media. And if you want to do it within a week, then you use the media like Optisol or Eusol. Okay, just remember the various names of the media at which the donor cornea is stored. Okay, very important question. Okay, now what is this instrument? I would like to give you a hint. This instrument is basically I use whenever I have to do a surgery in a congenital glaucoma patient. So it has two arms. See, one arm and two arm. What it can do is, I would give you another hint. It can basically help to open the Schlemm's canal. Now, can anyone answer? This arm would basically go and open the Schlemm's canal. Okay, so what is this? This is the external arm and this is the internal arm. Internal arm can basically open the Schlemm's canal, and the hint I have given you that it is used in congenital glaucoma patients, this is a trabeculectomy probe. Okay, so remember, a congenital glaucoma, the treatment of choice is your trabeculectomy. And in trabeculectomy, I basically add a procedure which is called trabeculotomy. Okay, what is trabeculotomy? It is the opening of the Schlemm's canal. Can anyone tell me any other procedure which is also done in a congenital glaucoma patient? Remember, congenital glaucoma patients usually do not basically respond well to your conventional medications, medical treatment. So you have to go for the surgical procedure. And the answer here is, you can go for also a procedure which is called goniotomy, where you open or peel the trabecular meshwork. Okay, so these are the procedures which we can use in a patient of congenital glaucoma. If you are enjoying this session, please put your like button here. And also, if you want more sessions in the next coming month, please give me advice. What are you the things that you want as the YouTube sessions? What are the things you want as the special classes in the coming month? Okay, so sometimes what they can do is, they can basically give you a image like this. They would ask you what is the procedure that is going on. So this is a you can put your request in the comment section here also. Check. So in this procedure, what you are doing is, you are making a scleral flap, a partial thickness scleral flap, After making a partial thickness scleral flap, you are making an opening in the sclera, and through this opening in the sclera, you are making an alternative channel for the aqueous humor to flow to the outside. Okay, what is this procedure called? Where you are making an ostium, which is basically allowing your aqueous to flow to the outside. Aqueous from the ostium to go into the subconjunctival space. So this is not iridotomy, this is something which is called trabeculectomy. Iridotomy is just a opening in the iris. Okay, when you are having a subconjunctival bleb, then it is called trabeculectomy. Everyone get my point? Give me a thumbs up. Okay, let's move to a similar instrument. What is this instrument called? Calesian scoop, wire rectus, Calesian clamp, or entropion clamp? So you have an instrument where you have two handles. One handle is a solid handle which can be used to grip the tissue, and the other end is a fenestrated end. This fenestrated end, what it can do is it can basically make more of a tight grip. Okay, with tight grip, what it can do is it can provide the hemostasis as well. So what is this instrument called? This instrument is called Calesian clamp. Okay, this instrument is basically called Calesian clamp. So as you all know, you have a lipogranulomatous inflammation of a gland. Can you tell me which gland which causes a painless nodular swelling in the lid? So I write in the short form lipogranulomatous inflammation, which is painless. Tell me which gland is involved. So very good. It is your meibomian glands that are involved here. So during surgery of a calesion, which is called not incision and drainage, but incision and curettage, you use the instrument like this. In this instrument, what you use is that this fenestrated ring, this goes to the conjunctival side, and this solid ring basically goes to the skin side. Can you tell me the incision of a calesion, is it made on the skin side or is it made on the conjunctival side? So what I do is, if this is my calesion, I put and press the calesion, mark the calesion with my ring here. This is my calesion. I put a fenestrated ring here. So two thing is, it marks the calesion, and second thing is, because tightly I grip it, I can basically reduce the blood supply and avoid bleeding that happens during the surgery. So whenever we have a calesion, remember, we do basically use vertical incisions. Okay, why I use vertical incision? Because I want to avoid any injury to the meibomian ducts. Okay, these are the very important points. So remember, the fenestrated ring, I put it towards the conjunctival side, and the solid ring, I put it towards the skin side. Okay, now after I have put the incision, like a ice cream scoop, you have this scoop which is called Calesian scoop. So where I use Calesian scoop, so after making the incision, if I have to basically remove the lipogranulomatous material, so with this small scoop, I can basically remove the material and freshen the edges. Okay, so this is called Calesian scoop. See, such a small instrument, and see the top and the top scoop area here. Do not confuse the Calesian scoop with another scoop which is basically used in enucleation. Okay, so enucleation, you use another type of scoop. I would just show you. Okay, so this is the instrument that we use as a enucleation spoon. Can you see here, everyone? So this is one is used for enucleation. You would ask that, sir, one difference is the size of the scoop. Okay, the size of scoop is very small in your Kalesion, but it is larger in your enucleation spoon. What is the second difference that you appreciate here? See this instrument and see this instrument. What is the difference? One is the size. Definitely in enucleation, you have to remove whole of your eyeball, so it is bigger one. And second thing that you can appreciate here is, in this instrument, you have a fenestration here. Okay, what I call this? So this is something through which we can basically hold the, or this is a portion of where optic nerve head guard can be there. Can you appreciate, everyone? So this is your eyeball and this is your optic nerve. When I have to remove this one, I have to use an instrument which can basically be here, and it has an opening through which the optic nerve head can go. Okay, then with the help of a scissor, I can cut it here. Is it clear, Dr. Yogesh, Dr. Chahak, Dr. Sonika? So this is a enucleation spoon, and this is a Kalesion scoop. Is it clear, everyone? Okay. So the next thing is, we can basically use another type of scoop that is called Mule's evisceration scoop. So what happens in evisceration is, we just leave the sclera intact and all other portions inside the eye, that includes your iris, cornea, aqueous, vitreous, everything else we remove. Okay, so this we can use with this scoop. Okay, a larger one, and see the edges. See the edges. So it can basically curve through that. This is basically called evisceration scoop. Are you getting my point? Okay. Then we have the clamps. These are the entropion clamps. Okay, we can use it in entropion or ectropion surgeries. So see, it is also like a Kalesion clamp. You have seen the Kalesion clamp here? It is also a clamp. So remember, whenever the word clamp is used, clamp means something which can hold. Here, the strong side you are seeing, this is more of a plate. Okay, so this is the solid part which is more a type of a plate. What it can do is, you can basically put your lids on cover with here. Okay, so it is a more wide, so that when you do a incision in the lid, you do not go into the eyeball. Okay, this is called entropion clamps. Similarly, like entropion clamps, you can have ectropion clamps also. Okay, so I just show you how to differentiate between the lid clamps and your Kalesion clamp. Okay, do not confuse between both of them. Okay, so this is another instrument that we use in our lid surgeries. This is basically called a Jagger's lid spatula. Okay, it is not a clamp. So remember, whenever you are using a clamp, you should be having two surfaces there. Okay, so two surfaces, then we call it a clamp. And when you have just only an instrument like this, this is called lid spatula. Okay, this is also used for lid surgeries. Okay, so what I do is that when I have to make incision in the lid, I put this lid spatula beneath it. Okay, like lid surgeries like ptosis, so that when I have to make incision with the blade, when I have to use incision with the blade, it should not go and injure your cornea or sclera or the eyeball. Okay, That is the use of the lid spatula and the clamps, entropion and the ectropion clamps. Okay. Let's move to the next instrument, which is basically used to measure something. Okay. I can open this handle and then I can open this area. Okay. What is this instrument called? So after opening this one, I can open this one. So this is basically called a caliper. Okay. This is called a Kestrovich caliper. Very simple instrument. You must have seen it in the surgical instruments also. I told you, what is this instrument? This instrument is basically a enucleation spoon with a optic nerve head guard. So tell me any indication of doing a enucleation. So we have three surgeries. First one is enucleation. Enucleation is done whenever we have some intraocular tumors like retinoblastoma, malignant melanoma, uveal melanoma. Okay. Then we have two more terms that we have used here. The one is evisceration. So remember, what we do in evisceration is that we remove the cornea, we remove all the intraocular contents, including your uveal tissue, lens, iris, everything, but we just keep the scleral shell intact. Okay. After keeping the scleral shell intact, we can suture the scleral lens. Okay. So this maintains, I have put an implant inside, this maintains the shape of the eyeball. Okay. This is something which is done in the perforated traumas where, or let's say the corneal, perforating corneal ulcers where there is no chance of the visual recovery, but patient wants that at least his eye should be having preserved. Okay. Not because of the your visual purposes, but because of the cosmetic purpose. Then the similar surgery can be excentration, which we do it in the patients who have got extensive retinoblastoma. Okay. Let's say a extraocular retinoblastoma, which have involved the eyelids as well and the muscles as well. So there, each and everything, I remove your extraocular muscles, I remove your lids, I remove whole of your eyeball, and I also remove your periorbital fascia. I can do it in the extraocular retinoblastoma. I can do it in intraocular extension of sebaceous cell carcinomas. And I can also do it in the patients who have got a mucor mycosis. Okay, so in any of these patients, I can basically go with the excentration surgery. Okay. Then we have this instrument which we use. What is this instrument called and where we use this instrument? Try to answer. So can you see, these are the three models of an instrument, and this instrument, the edges we can basically use to open something. Okay. Opening something. So very good, Avinash. What is the name of this instrument? So definitely it is used for opening the puncta, and it is not Bowman's probe. I call it punctum dilator. Okay. It dilates the puncta through which we can go into the canaliculi through the Bowman's probe. Okay, so this is called Nettleship's punctum dilator. Is it clear, Dr. Sonika? Then after the punctum dilator is done, then we use Bowman's probe to open the canaliculi. If you can appreciate here. So these are my upper and lower canaliculi, and they go into the common canaliculi, which goes into the lacrimal sac, which goes into the nasolacrimal duct, opening into the inferior meatus. So what we can do is, after opening the puncta with the punctum dilator, I can use this Bowman's probe to go inside. Is it clear? So do not confuse between the Bowman's probe and the punctum dilator. Is it clear, Avinash? Okay. So now, what is this instrument called, which have something like a gun? Okay. I can press it like this and it would open a solid piece. So thank you, Avinash. please like the session. So this is something which is called a bone punch. Okay, a Kelly's or a Kerrison bone punch. Basically, it depends upon what is the size. The one which is more bigger, you can call it Kerrison bone punch, and which is a bit smaller, that is the Kelly's bone punch. Okay, so see here. Can you appreciate this? When we open, when we close, it can basically make a bony opening. You can make a artificial opening in your lacrimal bone, and this instrument you use in the patients where you have to do a DCR surgery. A decriocystorhinostomy surgery, which we use in the patients who have got a chronic decriocystitis or a nasolacrimal duct obstruction. So I write the indications: chronic decriocystitis, or nasolacrimal duct obstruction. Is it clear, everyone? So I show you the instruments again, which I use in the nasolacrimal duct system: punctum dilator, then we have the Bowman's probe, and then it is the bone punch. Okay, let's move to the next question. So tell me, what is this surgery which is going on? You are basically making an opening in the anterior capsule, and then you are basically mapping the nucleus and using your laser to crack the nucleus. What is this surgery going on? Very good. It is a FLACS, that is called a femto laser assisted cataract surgery. We sometimes also ask, what is the wavelength of the femto laser that is used? It is 1053 nanometer. Okay. This is a femto laser assisted cataract surgery with multifocal IOL that is going on in my hospital. And this is another instrument that we use just to make capsular access. It is also a laser probe that is going inside, and it is making a capsular access. It cannot basically cause the, or it cannot do a nucleotomy. Only thing what it can do is a anterior capsular access. Can you tell me, what is this instrument called? Laser to make anterior capsular access. This instrument is called a Zepto laser. Okay, now we go forward to our next session, that is few investigations in ophthalmology. So anyone who have joined late, we are doing our investigations and instrument session. We are done with the instruments. You can just see the recording also if you have any doubt. And now we would go to the investigations in ophthalmology. Give me a thumbs up if all of you are here. Okay, so the first investigation that we would talk about is a ERG, the electroretinogram. So in an electroretinogram, we have a waves like this. So we have three waves. Sorry, my pen tab was opposite. So let me make my pen tab straight. So we have three waves here. This wave is called A wave, B wave, and C wave. Okay. So B wave basically represents which of the cells? Your options are amacrine cells, photoreceptors, bipolar, or ganglion cells. Try to answer. So this is basically, friends, a ERG, electroretinogram. So A wave is something which is a cornea negative wave. Okay, what we do with the ERG is we basically take the potential, that is a corneoretinal potential. I put a contact lens. Okay, one of the electrode is there and other electrode is at your head. So this is a corneoretinal potential that we are basically taking care of, and it tells us about the activity of the various cells of the retina. Okay, so this is a ERG. The first wave is a cornea negative wave. ओके, सो ए वेव इज बिकॉज ऑफ योर फोटो रिसेप्टर्स. वट आर माई टू फोटो रिसेप्टर्स? दीज आर माई रॉड्स एंड द कोन्स. बी वेव, बी गोज विद द बाइपोलर सेल्स. सो बेसिकली बी वेव टेल अस अबाउट द बाइपोलर सेल्स एंड इट ऑल्सो टेल्स अस अबाउट द एक्टिविटी ऑफ मुलर सेल्स. सी वेव इज अ इनकंसिस्टेंट वेव. समटाइम्स इट इज देयर एंड समटाइम्स इट इज नॉट देयर. इट बेसिकली शोज द वैल्यू ऑफ रेटिनल पिगमेंट एपिथीलियम. सो कैन आई से इट डॉक्टर सोनिका फ्रॉम दिस ग्राफ दैट ए वेव टेल अस अबाउट द फोटो रिसेप्टर्स? इट इज अ नेगेटिव वेव एज कंपेयर टू द बेस लाइन. गिव मी अ थम्स अप. बी वेव टेल अस अबाउट द बाइपोलर ऑफ मुरल सेल्स. इट इज द लार्जेस्ट वेव विच इज अ पॉजिटिव वेव. एंड सी वेव इज अ प्लस माइनस. Sometimes it happens and sometimes it does not happen. So if it is there, it tells us about the activity of RP. So what I can tell us about the ERG is that ERG, what is the limitation of ERG? ERG cannot tell us about the amacrine cells. ERG cannot tell us about the ganglion cells. And its value in any of the patient who is having a RPE disturbance, okay, it does not have too much sensitivity. Can you appreciate this? So ganglion cells, amacrine cells cannot be investigated by the ERG, and RPE health cannot also be seen with this investigation, which is called ERG. Okay, so you would ask me, sir, then what is the use of ERG? So ERG is basically recording the change in the resting potential of the eye, and the resting potential of the eye, the main cells that are responsible for that is your rods. Yes, definitely cones are also responsible, but rods being more in the number. So if you have any disease of the rods, can you anyone tell me any disease where predominantly all the rods are involved? So like your retinitis pigmentosa, like your toxicity of the metals, like your sidrosis bulbi, okay? In these cases, like your extensive diabetic retinopathy, where there are changes to the rods and the cones, it is a very useful investigation there. Second thing, it can tell you about the prognosis of the disease. So if the ERG is going down, so this means there is a continuous toxicity that is going on in the retina, okay? So these are the basic functions or the uses of electroretinogram. And here we have three waves, as I told you. A wave, that is the cornea negative wave due to photoreceptors like rods and cones. B wave, because of the bipolar cells and the Müller cells. And C wave, because of the RP. Is it clear, everyone? Till now, any doubts till now? So those friends who are who have joined this session, I am Dr. Vineet Sehgal. You can use my code, that is Dr. Vineet 10, to see my all the free live classes, special classes in the Unacademy learning app also. And whenever you install the Unacademy learning app, you can use my code, that is OFTHEL10, to basically enroll for that. And you can basically only then be able to see my live classes, where we would be having a retina A to Z series. Okay, retina A to Z series. What it means is that in this series, I would be talking each and everything about the retina and the uvea that you know. These would be 2-hour sessions, would be done on the 4th, 5th and 6th of February from 9:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Okay. Let's move to the next question. So Sunshine, it would be for both the NEET PG and professional exams. So those students who want extensive things about your preparation, they go for that, because I would cover the theory, I would cover the practical part, I would cover the MCQ part, and I would cover the images also. Okay, everything would be there. Okay, so the next question is, we know the electroretinogram is decreased when there is a continuous toxicity to your retina. My question is ki are there any diseases which can also cause increase in the ERG potential? Try to answer. So my question is anything which where the ERG potential can increase, the waves, the amplitude. Okay, so what is mean by amplitude of the wave? If this is your graph, this is small amplitude and these are large amplitudes. So initially in the disease there were small amplitude and then there were large amplitude. So the answer here is very good, Dr. Veena. It is C, that is early sidrosis bulbi. Remember, when there is a late toxicity, there is a decrease in the amplitude. But in the early cases, sometimes there is excitation of the photoreceptors. Because of these excitation of the photoreceptors and the other retinal cells, we get a paradoxical increase in the ERG potential. These are some important points, more so for the students who are preparing for the INICET exam, can be asked in their exam. Okay, so yes, amplitude is the height of the wave and latency is after the stimulus, when is your wave starting to show. Okay, that is amplitude and latency. Amplitude is the height, this is my height. Okay, I write it A, that is amplitude, and this is latency, onset of the stimulus to the onset of the wave. Okay, this is called latency. Okay, so now where are the uses? I told you uses are very high in any patient of the retinitis pigmentosa, Leber hereditary optic neuritis, even in extensive retinal detachment and severe diabetic retinopathy, you can use there. Remember, when there is a macular dystrophy, if you have the problem only in the macula, you know, in the center of the macula, you have very few rods. In optic atrophy or visual pathway lesions, the vision is low, but the ERG is not useful. Okay, in that cases, what we can be, Rashid, the recordings would also be visible. So in macular atrophy, dystrophy, optic atrophy or visual pathway lesions, we cannot use retinitis, we cannot use ERG there because ERG would tell us about the total function of rods and cones. If you have only focal deficiency of rods or there is a focal toxicity to the cones, this investigation would not be so much useful. Okay, now for these things, we have another investigation which is called multifocal ERG. Okay, so my question to you is multifocal ERG would be helpful in diagnosing which of the following diseases? Your options are retinitis pigmentosa, macular toxicity by the drugs, retinal detachment or optic neuritis. Try to answer. So in multifocal ERG, you can get a waveforms like this. So maximum graph, the height of the graph basically tells you about the activity of the cells. And tell me which portion of the retina has the maximum sensitivity of the light. So we all know the maximum sensitivity of the light, or I can call it hill of vision, is at the level of center of the macula. So if I have got a macular toxicity or a disease which is specifically affecting the macula, like a macular dystrophy, in that cases the multifocal ERG, which can specifically topographically tell me which of the places are basically affected and which are not affected, that can be told by this investigation. Okay, so this is one is multifocal ERG. So this is a normal one. Let's say after chloroquine or any drug toxicity, you have got this ERG pattern. So see, rest is normal. You are having decrease in the sensitivity at the level of macula, where the hill of lesion is there. So that is the use of the multifocal ERG. Okay. So thank you very much for attending this session. We covered few of the investigations like ERG and multifocal ERG. We also covered a lot of instruments in this session. If you like the session, please subscribe for the channel, that is the Let's Crack Neat PG YouTube channel, and you can use my code, that is OFTHAL10, to do more of the special classes that would be taken care of the at the Unacademy Learning app. Till then, it is goodbye from my side and have a good day. This is the last month of the day, so give your maximum in this day and always audit your preparation. What I mean by auditing your preparation is that see, whole of the month, what are the days, how many days you gave your maximum, and if you think that is there any scope of improvement, because remember, the only thing that is constant in the world is the change. So unless you improve every day, every week and every hour, you would not be better from someone else. And remember, this NEET PG, NIIT, and I would say the medical field, okay, we have come with the Covishield vaccine. I have got the Covishield vaccine few days back. I got a slight amount of fever, but I am absolutely fine. And then we have a Covaxin and something. So everything would change. Earlier we have H1N1 virus, then we have a COVID virus, and maybe 5 years down the lane, we would be having some new diseases. So you have to make yourself better, more competent, be a good doctor, be a better human being. That is what I can tell to you. Till then, it is goodbye from my side.